Börja med att hälsa Metin Bakanshi välkommen hit. Metin är generalsekreterare för Human Rights Foundation of Turkey. Metin är läkare och han har varit en av dem som har bidragit till Istanbulprotokollet, som är det protokoll som vi idag ska få lära oss mer om och som då handlar om tortyrskadeutredningar.
Thank you very much for this invitation, dear Monica, first of all. It's a chance for me to talk with you on torture issue, particularly in this day, 26 June. I have only, want to say only one sentence. We are very glad to be in contact with Red Cross Center in Stockholm for many years, 1992, 22 years. We are nice, very productive cooperation, collaboration, solidarity. It's very meaningful for all of us. So on behalf of Human Rights Foundation of Turkey, I want to say our thanks again. Now, as Monica and Frida told, we are talking about the Istanbul Protocol manual on the effective investigation and documentation of torture and other forms of ill treatment. The nickname is Istanbul Protocol. You know, Istanbul is one of our nice city. Maybe some of you at least could have a chance to visit there. I think, and it's a post-war, very nice view. This is a Taksim Square in the city center. I think if you visit there, I absolutely believe that you want to see square, Taksim Square. But Taksim Square is nowadays a bit cloudy. Cloudy, this is not a normal cloudy, this is a tear gas cloudy, because in the recent months, at least unfortunately, security forces use a very violent methods to the demonstrators. I will talk something about that. Today, yes, 26 June. Why 26 June is a General Assembly declared the United Nations International Day in support of victims of torture, a special day, 26 June, because many years ago, 1987, 26 June, United Nations Convention Against Torture entered into force. It's a special day, 26 June, because of it. And as Frida told, this is the 30th anniversary year of the United Nations Convention Against Torture, which was adopted by the United Nations General Assembly in 1974. My presentation has two main parts. One of them, the definition of the torture issue, definition of torture, changes in torture pattern, prevention of torture. The second part, main part, is the prevention of torture. Of course, at the end of my speech, I'm not an expert in Sweden, of course, but it would be very nice to talk about the Istanbul Protocol practices in Sweden also. Maybe I want to say some final words in the conclusion session. Yes, I want to speak about the ticking bomb scenario. I think at least some of you maybe heard such a scenario, ticking bomb scenario. Mm-hmm. Suppose that the perpetrator of an imminent terrorist attack that will kill many people is in the hands of the authorities, and that he will disclose information needed to prevent the attack only if he is tortured. Very old scenario, but unfortunately, in particularly after 11th September, even in 2001 in USA, tragically, of course, they put such an agenda at the desk again. It's a very dangerous. It's a hypothetical thought experiment. Of course, if you ask such a question, should he be tortured in order to save the innocent lives of the innocent people? Maybe some of them, your daughters, your mothers, your relatives, for example. This is a very dangerous question. If you ask such a question, Maryland University conducted such a research in 20 countries. Sweden is not there. Turkey is there, maybe you noticed here. If you ask such a simple question to anyone in the street, unfortunately, for example, 51% of the society in Turkey accept torture. Unbelievable. This old story has been forced again nowadays in all over the world. There are many other surveys and questionnaires, but at least average 35% ratio of the society in all over the world, something like that nowadays, accept torture in order to save lives of the innocent people. Unbelievable. Why unbelievable? Because such a scenario has some assumptions, and such a scenario asks to the individuals. But police torture issue, like the slavery and genocide, for example, directly destroys of humanity. From the morality and ethics side, but at the same time the legal side, it should be absolutely prohibited. Because of it, United Nations Convention Against Torture clarified this issue very clearly. Never, ever torture. During the wartime, during the peacetime, this is a kind of a jus cogens norms. It's a legal word, huh? Jus cogens norms. No derogation. Because the torture issue is against all of our humanity. All of us. But unfortunately, like the torture issue, torture-related article in the United Nations Human Rights Declaration, there is only one article which has no exception. For example, when you look to right to life, there could be some exception. We can discuss it, but there might be some exceptions. But torture issue, there is no exception. It shows us that at the same time, as you know, United Nations Human Rights Declaration, main slogan in that time, never again to see the pains, in particular, which we witnessed during the Second World War, never again, but after 66 years later, we can say that, like the Kofi Annan, the previous Secretary General of the United Nations, we have reached a fork in the road. Because many values have been destroyed in all over the world. So because of it, we all have a duty to do whatever we can to restore that respect. When we are talking about the torture, maybe we can think that it's a little bit historical discussion. Is it? For example, for Turkey, as I showed the photographs, during the recent months, for example, maybe you heard there, which is called Gezi Events. Gezi is the famous park in the Taksim Park, district in Istanbul. In all over the country, more than 3.5 million, for example, people attended the demonstrators, and unfortunately, they faced very big violence by the security forces and some people, including the children, Berkin, 14 years old, were killed, and thousands of people were wounded, thousands of people were tortured in that time, and it's ongoing nowadays. Because of it, our applicant number, for example, Human Rights Foundation of Turkey was founded in 1990. When you look at our applicant number, it naturally increased very dramatically, and it is the same in this year also. Torture issue is very important in Turkey. For example, in 1980, there was a military coup, and since the military coup till today, approximately 1 million people were tortured in Turkey, approximately. Our population is approximately 76-7 million nowadays, so it's a very huge number. Because of from the health disciplines, we are calling it torture is a public health problem. So it should be well structured in order to cope to such a health, public health problem. The other side, one of the main reasons of the torture issue, as you know, impunity of the perpetrators. Since the military coup, yes, nearly 1 million people were tortured. but for the legal proceedings could be taken for approximately 10,000 of them. Nearly thousands of these cases were convicted, but unfortunately, in almost all of these, punishments were either postponed or converted into fines and the other things. Impunity issues is ongoing nowadays for the Gezi events. For example, even if there were thousands of torture events, there is no any prompt, effective, impartial investigation against the torture perpetrators, but because of their participation of Gezi protests, many people put on the trial, including the physicians, including our colleagues put on the trial, because they try to treat the wounded people, tortured people. So perpetrator for impunity for the perpetrators, torture perpetrators, but at the same time, including the health professionals put on the trial. We are calling it counter cases or twin cases. Mm-hmm. Not limited in Turkey. Last month, Amnesty International published its annual report. At least in more than 140 countries, torture is one of the main problems in all over the world. Last month, United Nations High Commissioner of Refugees published their annual reports also, and in all over the world, there are more than 60 million refugees, and there are more than 33 million internal displaced persons by the end of 2013. As Monica said, yes, we are talking about millions of people. Those are the official figures, official numbers. You can estimate that, you can imagine that. Naturally, a real internal displaced person is more than those figures, of course. And please look at such a diagram. Even if internal displaced persons increased very dramatically, currently, in the recent years, currently in our region, Syria, Iraq, or etc., more than 33 million. But please look at the refugee figures, huh? It's the same. What's the meaning of it? So this is another big discussion, of course. This is not a today discussion, but another discussion. Definition of torture. Torture, yes, any act by which severe pain. There are some components of torture issue. One of them, we are talking about the deprived of liberty, the person who deprived of his or her liberty, first of all. The second, severe pain. The third, purposes. Not limited with the obtaining information or confession. At the same time, other purposes, punishing the people, or intimidating the people, or for any reason based on discrimination of any kind. Those are the different purposes of torture. And such a pain is inflicted by public officials or other person acting in an official capacity, of course. Nowadays, in the convention, as you know, there is a unique title, torture and other ill treatment, torture and cruel, inhuman, degrading treatment, etc. We are using the old word, but some there are some discussions to force the differences between the torture and ill treatment. What is the meaning of such kinds of discussions? It's very dangerous because conditions that give rise to ill treatment frequently facilitate torture issue. Because of it, the convention and the United Nations Committee Against Torture General Commands define this issue is very clearly. Obligations to prevent torture and ill treatment under article are indivisible, interdependent, and interrelated. So we should, against it, particularly from the health disciplines, absolutely the same way. There are many causes, as you can imagine, of torture, historical, cultural, psychological, political. At the root, it's the discrimination. At the root, it's the discrimination. And the purpose of torture, from one side, is to destroy the self-confidence, self-respect, or psychological and social integrity of the individual level, but at the same time, is to suppress the society on a social level, to ensure the obedience, etc. Because of it, torture issue is denial of the natural democracy and the consequences of torture. Because of it, on an individual level, there are some consequences naturally, family level and the social level. Of course, there are some links between them also. I want to say something about the changes in torture pattern. As we discussed a little bit before, when you look at the terminology in the conventions, the purposes of torture, obtaining from information or convention, it is related to the criminal procedure. At the same time, punishing. Punishing the people. For example, punishing the demonstrators, for example, who are deprived of their liberties at the same time. But at the same time, intimidating means of deterrence for the future, to give a message to the society. So, on these, of course, there are close links and there are common area, sometimes those area in larger, sometimes smaller. So it is not an arithmetical, of course, plus, but it is also affected the torture methods, techniques. For example, if they need, to get confession, for example, they can use a more brutal methods, for example, or they can secret them, for example. But if they want to give a message to the society, it can open and it can use very widespread, like those figures. In all over the world also, because of it, for example, this is a new decision of the United Nations General Assembly resolution. It was distributed in February 2014. They put, for the first time, a special paragraph, deeply concerned about all acts which can amount to torture and other treatment committed against persons exercising their rights of peaceful assembly and freedom of expression in all regions in the world, including Turkey or in many countries. They formulated this paragraph for the first time this year. So torture issue does not limit it with the official detention centers or prisons, etc., etc. If you are talking about deprived of liberty, someone, you can discuss or you can look whether torture and other forms of ill treatment happen or not. In all over the world, secret detention places, for example, you know, Guantanamo, for example, Abu Ghraib prisons. For example, what is the meaning, what is your impression about a lady, a woman, and Abu Ghraib prison, you know, famous views, you know. In the 1970s, some of people tried to find or conducted a kind of, unbelievable of course, scientific researchers. And on base of those researchers, they found that the severe pain for the Sunnis men, for example, is to be naked before a woman. So this is not coincidental view, finally. This is a very severe pain. Maybe that those men, for example, didn't have such a severe pain because of the Palestine hanging or electricity, etc., etc. But this view is a very severe pain. So, we have to think what are the changes in torture pattern, because in all, if we can clarify such a trend, we can clarify what we have to do in order to prevent torture issue. The health disciplines we prefer to use about the prevention issues for all the items, as you know, primary, secondary, tertiary. Primary, totally eradicate the practice of torture, so our aim is to society. Secondary level, reduce the number of torture, so our aim is some professionals, police, security forces, judges, etc. Tertiary, reduce the results of torture. Aims at individuals, Red Cross Center or Human Rights Foundation of Turkey to at the same time try to reduce the results of torture. But it should be holistic. Holistic prevention issue before the violation, accountability of the perpetrators after the violation, and right to a redress of the torture survivor after the violation. Each should be also holistic. Each title should strengthen each other, and of course, prevention of torture should not be medicalized. Of course, medicine is health professionals, health issue is very important, but it should not be medicalized only. So, because of it, all the international the instruments clarify the state obligations and the responsibility. Obligation not to torture, obligation before the violation, as I told to you, obligations after the violation. You can imagine, for example, effective monitoring of the detention places, safeguards against torture for those deprived of their liberties. False conventions cannot be used as evidence, of course. Training programs, non-refoulement, no transfer to country where torture is likely. For example, there are some examples in Sweden, also in your country, in any way. After the violation, effective investigation and documentation, and also the ensure the alleged perpetrators are subject to criminal proceedings. In this year also, United Nations General Assembly adopted a very nice, very well-structured resolution about the right to redress of the torture survivors. Very specific resolution. It is based on the Committee Against Torture General Command 3, which was adopted in 2012. Both of them are very well-structured issues, and in that case, right to redress, including the remedy and reparation for torture survivors, should have some substantive obligations, which are restitutions, compensations, rehabilitation, satisfaction, and guarantees of non-repetition. It should be also holistic. And also the procedural obligations. When we come to the rehabilitation, rehabilitation issue itself, yes, very strong medical perspective, but it should not be also medicalized at the same time. And also rehabilitation services is a kind of a services implementation, but it should be based on the scientific level, so scientific research is very important. We should exchange, implement exchange of experiences, activities in order to reproduce our knowledge. Those are the education programs at the same time. Scientific researchers, Murais Fandi, our colleagues in Turkey, I have to say it, started the first some important scientific researchers in all over the world at the end of 80s, in the beginning of 90s, for example. One of them, bone scintigraphy. For example, those are the typical views, lesions of PT, for example, but unfortunately it disappears within the 2 or 3 weeks, for example. After that, you cannot see anything. Even if you cannot see outside of the body, by using of the bone scintigraphy, we put a special materials in the blood, and the we can those traces in our costa or those traces in our foods, for example, shows us that there were some. Torture issue, even if after 25 years later, for example, in that case, or some days, 30 days later, for example. Another one, for example, this is the testis, sometimes you can see the lesions, but sometimes you cannot see. So by using autodynamic three-phase scintigraphy, those accumulations, for example, shows us that there were some traumatic processes in the previous time. So, for example, skin biopsy, those are the electricity, you cannot see because of the view, electricity and shock lesions here, but sometimes you cannot see. So, by means of the histopathology examination, those infiltrative lesions, for example, shows us that there were some electricity shock in the previous time. On basis of those scientific researches, we started to prepare alternative forensic medical reports. Why I want to say it? Because on this accumulation, we came to Istanbul Protocol issue. Istanbul Protocol, naturally, this one, you know, international guideline, United Nations guideline, unique guideline for the effective psychological, physical and legal investigation and documentation of allegation of torture and other ill treatment based upon the needs of daily life. This is a critical one. So I can say that Istanbul Protocol is a major tool in the prevention of torture issue itself. From our side, the history of Istanbul Protocol is Baki Erdoğan. Baki Erdoğan. He was killed in 1993 in the detention center by torture, unfortunately. And the official forensic medical report, unfortunately, was a false report, and that report said that there is no torture. After that, we prepared an alternative forensic medical report by using many methods, etc., etc., and it showed that, unfortunately, Baki was killed by torture. After 9 years later, European Court of Human Rights took a decision that he was tortured. After 9 years later, referred to our alternative forensic medical report. After European Court decision, our, in Turkey, Supreme Court decided that he was killed by torture, even if the perpetrators sentenced 5 years. In any way, it's unmeaningful, but in any way, it's a very strong. After that, we improved our alternative forensic medical reports, and we started to share our experiences with other colleagues in all over the world. And in the beginning of 1996, we started to prepare the drafts with the particularly Vincent Aycopina from the Physician Human Rights USA and the other colleagues. And it was 3 years effort, yes. And with the contribution of 75 experts in different disciplines, particularly health and law, and from 15 countries, more than 40 organizations. And final meeting was held in March 1999 because of the nickname became Istanbul Protocol. After that, we submitted, those are the participating organizations. In that time, it was a very real teamwork in that sense. And after that, we submitted to the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights, in that time, Mary Robinson, in Geneva. And then in the related units of the United Nations adopted, including the General Assembly in 2000. And all the regional bodies and the regional courts after that referred, and it was translated many languages, more than 18 in any way. And the protocol has referred since the beginning by all related organizations, internationals, regional, etc., etc., United Nations, European Union, European Court of Human Rights, World Medical Association, etc., etc., and also European Union Asylum Procedures Directive 2013 referred it directly and very openly, as you see. National measures dealing with the identification and documentation of symptoms and signs of torture. Finally, in procedures covered by this directive, may be based on Istanbul Protocol. Very clear. So it is absolutely international accepted document. We should respect and we should improve it. Also, the protocol is referred as all those documents. The protocol is referred as a useful tool, and it is stated that for this purpose, all the governments should establish and operate effective domestic procedures in accordance with the protocol. Why did we need such a protocol? From one side, yes, in that time also, there were many international and regional human rights instruments set for the principles of prohibition of torture. But at the same time, from the other side, unfortunately, in that time or today, torture is a very big problem in many countries, so there's a very big gap. So practical steps on how to implement these principles have been developing day by day. Finally, accumulation of experiences, legal or health or the other professionals' experiences, have been developed day by day. Naturally, there's a need for exchanging of different experiences, but there's a very big need for standardization of the practices. So protocol manual is based on this need, standardization of the practices. It is not a, of course, closed document. It should be also improved on basis of the daily needs. Absolutely, absolutely. Objectives of the Istanbul Protocol, as you can imagine, it's a guideline on the investigation of cases of alleged torture, documentation, and reporting the findings of such investigation to the judiciary and other bodies. But it does not limit, because other, it should be applied to other contexts, for example, human rights investigation and monitoring, assessment of individuals seeking political asylum, and defense of individuals who confess to crimes during torture, and assessment of needs for the care of torture survivors. From the health professionals' side, unfortunately, we have some problems naturally in many other disciplines, like medical disciplines. In the case of health professionals who are coerced to neglect, misrepresent, or false evidence of torture, the manual also provides an international point of reference for health professionals and other. Some reasons of the false, there are some reasons, of course, such kinds of false reports. One of them, torture perpetrators generally aim at not to leaving physical at least lesions. Secondly, physicians are less likely, for example, I remember my undergraduate education program, there was no such a topic in our curriculum. For example, nowadays, some in Turkey, for example, some of the universities, by means of our colleagues, now it can be a special part in the university curriculum, for example. But finally, physicians are less likely, even if they are very expert, maybe in the violence, for example, violence, family or woman violence, etc. But torture issue. The torture survivor does not always connect his current symptoms with his or his or her history of torture. This is one of the, at the same time, the torture survivor frequently does not want to talk about his or her experiences to others, for example. For other kinds of health problems, naturally, the patients came to show his or her all details, pains, etc., etc. But torture issue is different, has many big differences from the other kinds of health problems. There may be some difficulties in recounting for the torture survivors. Some factors directly related to the torture experiences, blindfolding, for example, drugging, for example, or disorientation, time, place, etc., etc., those factors directly related to torture experiences. So it's not so easy to remember, etc. Factors related to the psychological impact of torture. Factors directly related to the cultural factors. Factors related with the interview conditions or communication barriers, safety, trust, etc. So only physical examinations or classical diagnostic tests mostly insufficient for diagnosis of torture. Even may lead to false reports. In Turkey, for example, there are many, unfortunately, colleagues wrote only, he is physical fit, for example. They didn't conduct any deeply interviews or laboratory diagnostic test, etc., psychological evaluation, etc., put such a letter. This is a classical, unfortunately, false report. So health professions are very important because we are the first contact escape gatekeepers to recognize victims, to reinitiate or refer for treatment in specialized centers. And torture is a kind of medical, it's a medical diagnosis, maybe you know, international categorization of disease and other health problems, for example, World Health Organization categorization ICD-10, there's a very specific code: other maltreatment includes torture, and Y7.3 by official authorities. So torture is a very concrete code in this area, and the other also categorization also referred naturally. So medical evidence is very important. It can demonstrate that injuries or other clinical findings recorded in the alleged survivors are consistent with the torture described. Very strong evidence. Yes, before the Istanbul Protocol, we tried to do the best, absolutely. But there were some new things via Istanbul Protocol process. For example, the meaning of teamwork became more clear, and importance of detailed medical history, importance of detailed medical examination, including the other diagnostic tests, bone scintigraphy, magnetic resonance, etc., importance of the photography, video is very important, psychological evaluation. Importance of psychological evaluation also became more clear, and interpretation of findings and the conclusion in the reports. On basis of those new things, at the same time, the content of Istanbul Protocol includes such things: legal standards, ethical codes, legal investigation, general interview considerations, physical evidence, psychological evidence, and some appendixes. And Annex 1, for example, the principles on the effective investigation of documentation of torture, it's called Istanbul Principles, is it? Annex 1, because it shows the minimum standards for the states in order to effective investigation and documentation of torture. Minimum standards. Those are the minimum standards directed to the states. Prompt, effective, independent investigations, and other. The content of Istanbul Protocol includes such things. So, there are many things you can imagine. Of course, physicians must oppose torture issue. General consideration section is not limited with the legal or health professionals. All the other disciplines related on related to those issues also should be taken into consideration in this part particularly, because of it is a common ground. For the interviews, procedural safeguards, techniques, risk of re-traumatization, the use of interpreters. It's each item is a kind of a specific title, so we should respect all of them. Gender issues, indications of for referrals, interpretation of findings, etc. Because of it, for example, Committee Against Torture in the general commentary referred very clearly. The committee considers the training of relevant police, prison staff, medical personnel, judicial personnel, and immigration personnel, including training on Istanbul Protocol, to be fundamental to ensuring effective investigation, because general consideration is dealing with all kinds of disciplines on this issue, of course. So all the experts from related professionals are determined to pay special attention to the related issues during the interviews. For the refugee, there are other kinds of risk, as you can imagine. There are other kinds of trauma, migration, acculturation, poverty, prejudice, cultural belief, etc. So such a principle, non-refoulement, is more important. Psychological response to torture related any conditions. It's a very, very complex issue. And then please don't forget that distress and suffering in all our daily lives are not in themselves pathological conditions. Sometimes normal response to societal pathology. So we are not talking about the diseases, health problems, etc., etc. Distress and suffering. Because of it, for example, such kinds of extreme life events, naturally, all the human beings respond something in some way. It does not mean that he has a health problem, she has a health problem, etc., etc. But sometimes, naturally, for many reasons, yes, acute stress reactions are today, or post-traumatic stress disorders, that's 2 years, or personality change after catastrophic experiences could be seen naturally, at least some of them. But they might not be all present in each cases. And also, if negative findings in regard to psychological sequelae, of course, we have to evaluate possible reasons, additional steps. But please don't forget that absence of evidence of medical evaluation does not rule out torture and other ill treatment, because there are other kinds of factors, as we discussed before. For the pro-accurate reports, because of it, and based on our previous discussions, include at a minimum circumstances of the interview, a detailed history, all physical, psychological findings, and interpretation of findings, and identification of examiners also should be recorded, should be written in the report. Now, within a few minutes, I want to say something of some of our experiences, particularly about the training programs with alone Human Rights Foundation of Turkey, or with the other, particularly IRCT, International Rehabilitation Council for Torture Victims, or Physician for Human Rights USA, or Redress, etc. We implemented many training programs in many countries. In Turkey, since the beginning, since, for example, 2001, we included many, many training programs. But one of them is very special because it's a kind of a council for forensic medicine. It's an official body, Ministry of Health and Ministry of Justice, to the particularly physicians, 3,476 physicians. They attended our training programs with the other organizations, of course. It's very valuable training program, because from one side, very valuable. For example, impact of that special training program, prior to training, only, approximately 30% of the participants, for example, think that, yes, torture can be used, in particular in some, on basis of some reasons, as we discussed in the beginning. But after training, it decreased to 2%, very dramatically. The importance of confidentiality before the prior to training, it was 17, for example. After training, it increased to 82. Very dramatic and positive change. The importance of psychological evaluation. Prior to training, it was only 60%. Those are the physicians, all of them. After the training, it increased to 97. So training is very important. But those 3,476 physicians, Minister of Justice, Health, change their position, change their places after the training program, all of them. So from one side, training is very important, but from the other side, training itself is not enough, at least. Training is very necessary, but itself is not enough. I'm not an expert, so Hans most probably on Ture will give some thing about in Sweden, but I can say that Sweden and international obligations, naturally, widespread implementation of Istanbul Protocol into investigation in Sweden is very important, of course, it's an obligation. Launching investigations in line with Istanbul Protocol and training of physicians and training of other related professionals are very important. Of course, for the promoting effective documentation of torture, there are some critical challenges. One of them, capacity and awareness on the Istanbul Protocol is still relatively limited, naturally, in all over the world. So we have to strengthen such kinds of activities, including the training programs. The other one, safety and personal integrity and dignity for the torture survivors and the health professionals and all the others. For example, some of our colleagues put on the trial because of their daily activities, for example, such a safety atmosphere, naturally, is one of the challenges. Independence of and impartiality of the examination is also one of the challenges. And the main, one of the main challenges, including in Turkey, unwillingness of states. As I told you, 3,476 physicians, all of them, they change their places. Willingness is very important, so we should establish. Istanbul Protocol is very important major tool, but where there isn't any legal norm, where free speech is not is a crime, where excuses are raised to legitimize torture and other ill treatment, neither a guideline nor a principle can be eligible to protect an individual, naturally. So because of it, we should improve our alternative practices. Because of it, we should strengthen our international solidarity like us. So because of it, we are very valuable. In conclusion, we are not talking about the victim. They are a real human being. This is not a charity activity. This is a solidarity. Of course, we should our activities should be based on an academic approach. And professional discipline, ethical values is very important. But this is not a kind of a professional itself. And human rights defender is a little bit discussable words. It's not a categorically distinct area. It's not an occupation, profession, etc. So for all kinds of activities, holistic, multidisciplinary, integrated approach is very important. And our dreams is very important for a more human society. So thank you very much. I think I can catch 1 hour. Huh? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mehdi. A lot of information in a short time, but in a perfect time as well. Well presented.
Kanal var. Bir kere bana. Bir de bitiyor.